Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining after lunch. I know it's a difficult hour, as was mentioned before. A little bit about myself. I'm an assistant professor of blockchain technology from the University of Copenhagen. I also have a PhD within the area from the University of Cambridge in the UK. And Firmo is about creating a secure infrastructure for a variety of products. A lot of them are around financial products. We are allowing a very, very strong and secure infrastructure around it. Working with secure infrastructure is something which I'm fairly familiar with. I started the first time 20 years ago during my army service for the Israeli Air Force, because an airplane in the air is a real-time system that needs to be 100% secure. And we strongly believe that this contract, as representing money, as was also mentioned in the talk just before me, is something that we have to secure. And we want to secure it on the level of the protocol. There is a lot of tiny details there, but I think I'll hook you up into a lot of the really, really cool stuff we're doing. Apart from it, we are early adopters in this space. We've been around since 2011 within blockchain, been part of the community, and we're members and contributing to other products. I'll talk about it a little bit later. So a lot of the people, I guess, around in the world has been seeing the staggering growth within the sort of blockchain market cap, which has also affected the risk around it. But I think one of the things which are extremely critical to look about is that this is a cash-based economy. Now, who is in this room sitting now with over $500 in their wallet right now? Right, I assume probably none of you guys, or maybe a couple of you coming just on a flight today. And the blockchain world, on the contrary, does have huge amount of wallets. These wallets, right, are having a large amount of risk within the wallets, and all the trading is done in cash. It's a cash-driven economy. And this is a huge, huge risk, right? We're talking about scaling a $600 billion market cap with the potential of changing the whole world, which is cash-driven. I mean, this is crazy. Forgive me for saying this word, right? We are paying with debit card or credit card every day for most of our transaction. This is not cash. We hardly use cash today, especially in the Western world. A side comment for that is also that the size of the non-cash world is also staggering, right? If we're talking about the futures and derivatives cap, these are huge, huge projects, right? We're talking about, if we compare the world GDP today, which is roughly $70 trillion, the size of the market cap of derivatives is between 10 to 15 times that. So if we want to have the vision of really going blockchain, going full in, we need to create a very, very tight, secure infrastructure around it. So what we aim to do is to actually put Firmo as the infrastructure that actually allows that kind of transaction, and we do it from a very, very technical point of view. I'll mention some of it, but with the little time we have here today, and I don't want to go too much technicality things, we can't go really deeply into details. But the idea is, you can see on the left side here, how complex is the supply chain today of a transaction between Alice and Bob, because a variety of members in the pipeline, because a variety of different databases that are using the pipeline that we need to sync. We have the promise of allowing that to happen on a blockchain with potentially a variety of other side chains, and we want to simplify this process. So we start working within the Ethereum ecosystem. The reason why we start there is because there are existing varieties of projects and elements that actually allows us to benefit from a thriving ecosystem. More specifically, we can use, oh, it's a bit hard to see, but we can use companies such as Oracleize, allowing us to get oracles and data on-chain, right? So we can actually transact things with data on-chain. We can deal with dollars today via Tether and some provider of stable coins, such as DAI. And we can also work with Paxos to get some metal prices directly on chain. Also, with the growth of decentralized exchanges, we also have the capacities to allow a variety of transactions directly on chain. Again, this growth also introduces risks. And let's talk a bit more about risk, and let's try to maybe get a little bit more deeper to what we mean when we talk about risks. So I guess the two most known examples, or very strong, let's call it blockchain anecdotes. The first one is, of course, the forking around Ethereum as a result of the DAO hack, right? So just to mention this, while this is talking about roughly $150 to $170 million sort of money that was under risk, keep in mind that that was roughly 20% of Ether on circulation. Shall I reiterate it? 20%. In today's market cap, we're talking about roughly $20 billion sort of, which were under risk. This is a huge problem. More recently, we've seen the Parity hacks around Parity wallet actually happened twice. And there are a few other examples we've seen also recently in Japan. And these are huge risks, huge risk for really scaling the business. The last thing, and then forgive me for utilizing my academic hat on top of it, is that this is really the tip of the iceberg. Because obviously, if we're running a contract with $50 between us, no one would like to hack this contract. No one has the interest of doing it. And there was an academic research looking about roughly 20,000, a bit below, contracts that were available on Ethereum, and found, using static analysis, some vulnerabilities in 45% of those. So what we're actually seeing, we see the tip of the iceberg, and with the growth of the economy, this is a really, really serious, serious challenge. So how do we approach this problem? We approach this problem by saying, it is fine to have languages that we can work with them directly on the blockchain, such as Solidity in case you're developing on Ethereum, and others if you're moving to your other blockchain of choice. We actually externalized this process. We created an external language which is very extensive, rooted in very deep academic research over the last 10 and 15 years, looking into how to certify code for financial contracts. So what are we referring to here? We're referring to creation of contracts in an external language. It's a functional language with all of the positives coming from working around functional language. And it's external to the blockchain. We'll talk in a second about the benefits of it. And then connecting it is way back to the blockchain by the means of compiling this code directly to the bytecode, and in that case, bypassing the use of retrying to write this language on smart contracts on Ethereum. So I'm super excited about it, actually, because I think it's the way to go. I think a lot of people within this technical industry also really like this direction. And just I'll say in two words about the insight behind the building of the language. So there are two insights. The first insight is if we move finite time, we can do much better technically. Sorry to bore you up with it, but what does that mean for us? It means that we can look into financial contracts as things that have time limits on top of it, right? If we take a loan, 30 years, some monthly payment, it's finished. We don't need infinite Turing complete machine to produce it. The same thing is that financial contracts finishing with a transfer. As you can see here also, if it's a bit difficult to see, our code always finishes either in the zero contract or a transfer. So after boring you with some of the technicalities, let's think about use cases for reality of real-time systems that are using it, right? We're trying to utilize the knowledge that we've built over the last 50 years, and more specifically, in issues which are real-time issues. As you remember before, I worked with airlines and airplanes code before that. We have cases where this security is ingrained, right? If we have about train scheduling, where life of people is on stake. If we're talking about airplanes in the air, where risks can mean life staking of people, and the same goes for satellites, right? We have a huge project that can have a bug inside it and we lose the satellite. So these issues are used here, and we believe this is very, very appropriate for the world of blockchain, where we have people that doesn't trust each other, but want to trust the infrastructure behind their technology. Some of the benefits here, I compare Coarser language to Solidity, is the fact that it's formally verified, which gives you a high level of trust in the code that you're actually creating via APIs and potentially templates that we issue or others will issue, and a built-in logic check. So for example, a code that will have causality problem, saying that, for example, will create a contract between us, and once you have to pay me back some loan, it will be based on the price 2 weeks afterwards. The code can stop it. Coding Chorus will not allow you to compile code like that. It will strike an error. So what is our vision into taking these technologies to the next level? Our vision is really moving and being parallel and independent of specific blockchain technology, right? We've seen the issues with kitties on Ethereum. We love the ecosystem, but we don't know how scalable it is. But by actually being external and writing a compiler directly to the bytecode, we can move later to anything else that supports such smart contracts. If Stella supports it, if we're talking about Neo, if we're talking about Quantum, we can actually utilize that. And we are super, super excited about it. Anything spellable before we're talking about DAG technology is something we're excited about being part of it. Also worth mentioning that we actually have a working prototype, and if people are excited about it, I can actually show you outside how we actually run a use case base-to-base, back-to-back on our platform. How do we see in very, very layman and simple methods working with our token economy and with our project is counterparties are meeting. This can be happen on a decentralized exchange. Again, we are not, we are creating the infrastructure for it. Later on, creation of a contract. This contract involve the Firmo token as part of the creation of it, as part of the interaction of the compiler and the full ecosystem. And once it's happened, the Firmo agents create you a deployable code of your blockchain of choice. At the first stage, we support a lot of Ethereum. Later on, in the future, you can re-execute the contracts at any given time and see the transference happening. This is also part of the prototype we're actually having up and running. So we are super excited about this technology. Later on, this can be easily integrated to a variety of marketplaces. Again, we are not a marketplace company, but we are a supporter of the infrastructure for such. And you can very easily define via our API or via future templates a variety of contracts. Our end vision is really having a lot of established financial products based on our protocol in a variety of exchanges which are portable between a variety of these. And we actually, by not essentially being an exchange, can be the medium to help this network of value move around. A couple of other projects we're involved and advising for is the Bancor protocol, where we help them co-writing the white paper with the founders, and the same goes for Kulu. And we are happy and to support the Tel Aviv ecosystem around blockchain. We have a growing team with a lot of experience, both experience on the business side. A few people in the team have actually went through a couple of exits and actually IPOs. And we also have the knowledge coming from both the sort of blockchain space, Kulu, and other technologies that are running here, to people with a lot of knowledge around technology. People that have worked as CTOs for a variety of projects, dealing with peer-to-peer loans before, dealing with financial contracts. And we have a strong UX and many developers of the team. We have a very strong academic board because we believe that our work has to be rooted in the most strong and applied academic research to be cutting edge. Some of the guys here, I won't bore you up with the details, but they are among the builders of the first financial contract domain-specific languages. Some of the people here work with some other models. Even before we knew about blockchain technology, about how to linearizing thoughts and decision-making around this project and scalability. So we're very proud to have this involvement with strong people. We're also personally committed to contribute to academic research on the subject because we think, and I personally strongly believe, this is really important. We also have a variety of strategic investors here. We have an advisor. We don't have the full list here. We also have iAngels here and a few other collaboration. We also have collaboration with marketplaces that want to work with our technology on top of it. We will release more information once these contracts are signed, but we are really, really excited about it. So I hope I didn't bore you too much with technicalities, but we are really excited about these projects, and we love to contribute to the space. So thank you very much for letting us being here today. Any questions?
Yes. What's the business model?
So the business model is, it's very much dependent on the case by case. We already, I think a lot of people were really excited about our technology and want to partner with us to allow them doing their business model. Like if we've seen the previous company, for example, that was presented here, they also want to securitize their code in between so they could utilize our technology. We talked to a variety of exchanges and also a variety of peer-to-peer loaning and securitization companies. So we will have some sort of, we will not be the front end. Think, for example, about yourself trading in a decentralized exchange. And as part of the fee process, there will be the token model use. So whenever we will allow, for example, a decentralized exchange and other exchanges to easily put ERC20 tokens that represent future contracts, while they do that, there is some fee that is paid. If it's fee paid by their own token or paid otherwise, some of this fee will be used to buy either directly or indirectly our token and burn it. So in this case, there is a fee paid for the services. We have three principles to make it very easy. The first one is we want to create the tokens in a very easy ERC20 so they can be moving around. So then it's very easy for them to list it, to market make it, and work with them. The second is to allow them move by not actually being an exchange yourself, because no one wants to list other exchanges' stuff. And the third level is to actually make the user experience around it very simple. So.
Thank you very much. You must move on.
Any last question? All right. So thank you guys very much, and we're very excited to speak here.